Welcome to Honest Reviews with Tiderion. Today we are taking a look at the much-anticipated Fallout 4. This thing has been a long time coming. Hell, there was a stretch of time when I wondered if it was even coming out at all. But here we are at release, and Bethesda has come through once again. So many questions to be asked and answered about this game, and there will be undoubtedly a million reviews to read, along with the entire spectrum of worst game ever, would not buy type of reviews, all the way to game of the year, 10 out of 10. And you can go out there and see any of those. But personally, while I have a great respect for the company and the series, I'm all about taking the game for what it is. Context is obviously important, especially when gauging if any progress was made for the previous games. But right now, we're here to figure out what this game is all about. So let's dive in. I think there are four main discussions to be had about this game. But first, we have to get through an important pretext. And that is, does the damn thing work? Naturally, this is an important question for any game, but especially so with the Fallout series. Well, Bethesda in general, to be fair. They just don't have the best track record of releasing bug-free games. Awesome games, to be sure. Games that almost immediately invoke images of Game of the Year and that kind of thing. But the releases, well, historically, they've been pretty rough. Fallout New Vegas' infamous release might still be fresh in some people's minds, and for good reason. Plenty of crashes, bugs, corrupted saves, it was bad. In fact, I had to stop playing it for several days until they got some basic and critically needed patches in. Then, of course, it went on to become one of my favorite games of all time. Well, the question of does it work is somewhat of a matter of perspective here. The simple answer for me has been yes, absolutely. I haven't experienced a single crash or a bug as of writing this, and that is about a million times better than Fallout New Vegas or Fallout 3 or Skyrim, which incidentally all still like to crash on me occasionally. So kudos to them for that. However, and while I don't have much sympathy for them in general, I feel really bad for the console kids on this one. After seeing some gameplay footage, I wouldn't blame them for being genuinely upset. The textures in their version look every bit as bad as mine do good, and they can't even hold a steady 60 frames per second, sometimes even dipping down to shockingly low numbers, while mine hasn't budged below 60 the whole time. On the other end of the spectrum, and given that this is still the Gamebryo engine, there are a number of bugs that can be found when unlocking the frame rate on PC. I'll certainly be attempting that at some point, but given the threads I've already read on the subject, I'll be waiting until some of that has been sorted out. So to answer that question with greater accuracy, I'll say the game runs flawlessly and without errors at the maximum unmodded settings on my PC. Now, rocking a 980 Ti and a 4670K, I'm not exactly hedging the minimum specs, but there are plenty of games out there that can challenge my rig, so I've been impressed with this so far. Moving on from the baseline of game performance, there are four topics that warrant discussion when reviewing Fallout 4. Game presentation, and that includes the graphics, overall feel and aesthetics, the quest, storyline, etc. Combat, crafting, and character customization. Fallout has been around for a long time. While 1997 might not seem that long ago, you might consider that half the people playing Fallout 4 right now may not have been born at that time, and that it was a DOS game. That's saying something. From my perspective, the modern generation of gamers were really introduced to this series with the release of Fallout 3 in 2008, which serves as almost a halfway point between the release of the first game and the release of Fallout 4. And while the setting of the series has always been the same post-apocalyptic sandbox survival adventure, the tone, mechanics, and game systems through which these stories have been presented has evolved greatly from one game to the next. The early RTS Fallout games were unforgivingly hard and didn't bother holding the player's hand at any point. And their key differentiation between themselves and the later games is obviously the medium through which the story and RPG mechanics are being presented, meaning real-time strategy rather than a first-person shooter. Fast forward to Fallout 3, and the tone has become much lighter, and now we're an FPS game. Sure, you still have the gritty blood and guts fighting and the harsh reality of the wastelands, including all the monsters and cannibals, that kind of thing, but you also had very silly encounters, like the anti-agonizer, etc. New Vegas seemed to move back to a darker feeling, with a very real-feeling conflict between the Legion and the NCR, and all the brutality involved therein. Of course, you still had some silly moments with Lily and the Black Mountain Radio, etc., but how silly can a game really be in which human crucifixion and mass genocide are prominently featured? The game dealt with some really dark human nature type matter as well. Boone's wife, Bitter Springs, and the fate of the Divide. And now we've arrived at Fallout 4. Of course, I'll have to enter the disclaimer that neither me nor anyone else has experienced everything the game has to offer as of yet. But so far, the game is pretty in your face. I had originally thought this was probably not going to be the case. My big clue to that was the Minutemen outfit on Preston shown in the original gameplay trailer. It had me kind of raising my eyebrows. But whatever else the game might be, it's certainly not kind. Without overtly spoiling any plot points, the game is pretty cruel even in the first 30 to 60 minutes of the main storyline. For the first time ever, you play witness to the beginning of the apocalypse, and then subsequently lose everything you have, waking up alone and disoriented in the post-nuclear war world that we're used to seeing. So far, I'm of a split mind about the storytelling. The story itself, I like, and I feel somewhat engaged in ways that I did not with Fallout 3. I very much enjoyed New Vegas' Machiavellian plots and how intricate of a part you could play with them, and I had just as much fun playing to the side factions as I did the main storyline. It's too early to say with 100% certainty how closely Fallout 4's narrative will follow or deviate from that style of completely open, choose-your-adventure-style gameplay, though I hope it aligns itself much more closely with New Vegas than it did Fallout 3. That being said, they've already managed to pack more unbelievably convenient plot devices in the first half hour than most games do in the entire story. Picture this. Just minutes before the world ends, the Vault Tech salesman just happens to sign you and your family up, just in time for you to run underground and survive the blast. Somehow. Even though you can literally see the fire from the blast passing over your head as the elevator descends, and that would certainly kill you. Anyway, then you just happen to be one of a small number of people that survived some tragic plots going on in the vault. You wake up from cryosleep just in time to witness these things. Then your Mr. Handy just happens to have survived the blast as well, though how he didn't melt from an atomic bomb going off a couple miles away is beyond me, and just happens to point you in the right direction of a town. On the way, Dog Meats just happens to be waiting for you at a Red Rocket station where there just happens to be your first crafting matches lying around. Then once you've helped the people of Concord, there just happens to be a stim-addicted psychic that can help you locate your son. Okay, really? Come on, Riders. As someone with a small kid, I can really identify with the quest of saving your child in a dangerous world, but did you really need like a half dozen Deus Ex Machina moments in the first half hour? A little more careful riding and a lot less hand-holding could have made a much better initial impression. So, then it's a really odd turn of events when the game turns around and chooses not to hold your hand when it comes to major game mechanics, like VATS, which, several hours in, the game has still not informed me even exists. If I didn't know it was in there already and hadn't gone looking for the correct hotkey to use it, I would never have known. But in general, I just don't agree with the direction they took the story, or how they asked you to experience it. And that's a matter of perspective, but let me clarify what I mean. Compare New Vegas with 4, and they might seem to both start off the same way. You create your character, you create your face, and then you take off after the person that took something from you. But that's really where the similarities seem to end. In New Vegas, you're a faceless nobody at the start of the game. That really doesn't change, except by your own hands, until you get to the Lonesome Road DLC, where we get some background on what you had done before the start of the game. But the rest of it's up to you, and that's reflected in the epilogue, depending on how you played the game, who you sided with. In other words, you're given a blank canvas on which you can paint who you become in that world, and what part you play in the events around you. Fallout 4 main character is already set. Yeah, you can choose to be a man or a woman, you can choose to be an asshole in conversations throughout the game, and you can choose to help or not help various side factions, but you will always be married and have a son, and you will always be on the same main quest line. Now, you might be able to solve them in a couple different ways, but you can't just decide to not do it. It's not like you could avoid the Hoover Dam battle in New Vegas either, but you could show up in 4 very different ways, with a multitude of side quest endings to go along with it. When you try to stick an extremely rigid narrative in an open-world game, you're playing a very dangerous game of dice. You are betting that you can write an emotionally appealing story that is so good that it can trump the freedom and replayability of a New Vegas-type system where you can literally choose your own path from start to finish. In my opinion, that gamble has not paid off, and it leads to, as I remarked earlier, a lot of hand-holding when it comes to progressing through the main storyline. Now, as for the world and how it's presented in general, I'm a fan so far. The PC version has none of the ugliness of the console counterparts. The textures are as non-revolutionary as you'd probably expect from a Bethesda game, but are still nice. And the general atmosphere they've created is a welcome change from the single color palette they seem to work with for Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas. I think the UI's presentation has moved forward a bit. I was a little dubious about the minimalistic approach at first, but I actually now appreciate the absence of tiny loading times and opening containers. That being said, as helpful as it tries to be, it's clearly underdeveloped, at least in the PC version. Menus have bare-bones keyboard and mouse support, and the default keys with which you navigate them are both inconsistently defined and mostly unchangeable. Depending on which menu you're in, sometimes you'll be asked to confirm if you actually want to leave it when you try to, and sometimes not. Sometimes you'll need to hit escape, other times tabs. It's like they didn't actually have a QA tester who played primarily with a keyboard and mouse while testing. armor, guns, enemies, animations, all of these things are vastly improved from the previous games. Of course, you'd expect that, but it's worth noting anyway. Also worth noting is that you won't find anything groundbreaking here, and coming from Bethesda, that's also not unexpected. You can find better versions of any of these things elsewhere, so you're left with things that are very well done, just not breathtaking. However, when taking into account the context of how rigid and lifeless the models and animations felt in Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas, this area in particular has seen drastic improvements. Enemies feel much more alive and animated, and actually remarked to myself out loud that for the first time ever, ghouls actually seemed ghoulish. They were always kind of creepy, but now they actually look truly rotten, and are often playing dead amidst the carnage that you run across, rather than just kind of skulking around like a crazy person. The feral ones are much more feral and move in a more animalistic way. And speaking of which, enemies in general now intelligently conceal their weak points when fighting. Check out how the Mirelurks duck into their shells when they're heading towards you, making them pretty hard to kill. The variation of areas and quests is very respectable and themed appropriately for the New England setting, as opposed to the Mojave of the previous installment, exactly what you'd hope for with the Fallout game. In the first hour of the game, and without wandering too far from the starting point, I had already encountered several different cities in various states of destruction, a train yard complete with a train wreck and a pack of ghouls, a subway station also complete with a bag of ghouls, and a flooded quarry where a lone prospector was fighting against Mirelurks in his own pumping system. And of course, all this kind of hand waves at the fact that all of them contain many nooks and crannies and secret areas to discover and explore, all while dealing with the dangers of radiation and the deadly enemies running around. However, quest presentation seems to be a step back from the previous game, in a lot of ways. Not that they're not interesting or varied, so far at least they managed to beat Fallout 3 in that regard, but the ways in which you can solve them are not. This is also reflecting the skill system in many ways, but I'll leave that discussion to its own section, and for now say that rather than the Fallout New Vegas style of letting you talk your way out of almost any quest-driven encounter, you're pretty much always experiencing some variation of shooting your way out of things. Not that that's particularly inappropriate in a shooting game, but it does break ties with previous games' precedents of allowing peaceful or clever alternatives to fighting. You still have social skills that you can develop, but so far, those are reserved for speech checks when kind of getting to know characters, trying to get more money out of them, rather than finding non-violent ways to resolve quests. Disappointing, considering I liked being able to peacefully navigate my way through quests in New Vegas when I felt like it, or just didn't want to kill the character. Next up, we'll talk about the new combat system. The quality of the gunplay was a major concern of mine, as I stated in my Fallout 4 preview video. Fallout 3 had very underwhelming combat, and while Fallout New Vegas made respectable strides in that department, including iron sights and a much bigger selection of guns, it was still not up to par when compared head-to-head with virtually any other AAA FPS title, being saved instead by its well-developed RPG mechanics and open-world nature. So how does Fallout 4 stack up? Actually, it's amazing. Having put well over 500 hours into Fallout New Vegas, I'm very familiar with how that combat looks and feels, and yet from the first few bullets I fired in Fallout 4, I was already sold on it, and it's only gotten better from there. While I haven't found nearly all there is to find as far as weapons go, the variation so far has been adequate, without even getting into crafting yet, which I'll cover shortly. There's been a mixture of improvised and military-grade weapons covering the usual variety of ammunition and character build types, which will play against the perk tree for maximum effectiveness. Gunshots sound and feel better, with enemies actually having a perceptible response to getting shot, or animations feel more alive and less canned. Even on very hard, guns feel appropriately powerful without feeling either overpowered or like a Nerf gun. Even fairly early on, enemies come in larger groups than you usually experience in previous games, which makes combat feel much more frantic, in a good way, and requires you to be cautious about how you fight and move. Speaking of which, despite good aim and use of VATS being an important equalizer, combat is decidedly not easy. At least not on very hard, where enemies aren't exactly bullet sponges, but are very dangerous if you're being careless. In fact, the first raider I came across killed me because I wasn't paying attention. Headshots are extremely effective, but enemies move much more fluidly and quickly in this game, so there will be a learning curve with good aim being more important than ever. VATS is still useful, of course, but it's no longer a pause button, and isn't an unlimited resource. You can even initiate guaranteed critical hits when needed, but to compensate, random criticals are gone. So far, ammo has been a bit scarce, and it's a complaint I've seen running through several other discussions as well. I'll speak more about these implications in a moment when I cover crafting and skills, but for now, it's worth noting that you don't often have the ammunition to use your favorite guns at all times. I've actually added 5 different guns to my hotkeys, all different types, so I can prioritize their use based on my ammo reserves and the difficulty of the enemies I'm fighting. Good thing I had a couple hundred 5mm rounds lying around when I stepped into that parking garage and came face to face with a half dozen ghouls in tight quarters. Now my minigun is empty, but at least I'm alive, so I guess that's a fair trade. Another huge question mark the developers left with us when they gave us a teaser of it during the E3 presentation was exactly how crafting would play out. The quality of the crafting system design and importance in the game could have gone either way, being either an annoying and useless side profession or a fun and engaging addition to the game. Personally, I found it to be the latter very firmly. From the moment I got access to the weapons bench, I was hooked and became obsessed with locating all the little odds and ends I would need to create the guns I wanted, only being frustrated by all the things I wasn't able to make right then and there. I would like to point out that while there may be 15 or so receivers, barrels, etc. for any given gun, you're really looking at more like 5 variants with 3 quality levels. I'm paraphrasing a bit here, but you get the idea. Meaning 15 different receivers doesn't mean 15 functionally different ones, just 4 to 5 different types with several quality levels each. Nothing wrong with that. There's still an unbelievable amount of customization for every gun I've found this far, but worth noting nonetheless. I say guns, but really everything from energy weapons and melee weapons to armor have the same level of customization, sometimes even deeper. I was shocked to learn that they had expanded the armor system so much in general, in fact, moving from the traditional helmet and body armor to actually separating it out into 6 pieces. Helmet, chest, right shoulder, left shoulder, right legs, left legs. In addition to that, there are a couple options for helmet, like being able to wear goggles or a bandana with an open helmet, and you have a base suit you wear under everything. You start out with a vault suit, of course, but there are many others. That's a lot, especially when you consider you can customize most, if not all of that. Crafting, both personal equipment and base items, was also very slickly designed. By that I mean it was done in the least annoying way possible. Generally speaking, it's not actually all that fun to run around searching for the components you need to craft something in a game. Very few games can make resource gathering a non-chore, but you can at least help someone along the way, and Fallout 4 does just that. Anytime you're looking for a recipe in a crafting station, you see the components, and you can see your progress of gathering what you need. But right there in that same screen is an option to highlight what you don't have, and let yourself know when you come across a compatible component in the world. For instance, if I needed an aluminum for a specific recipe, I could tell it to highlight those, and the next time I came across an aluminum can in the world, when I looked at it on the ground, it would put a very noticeable magnifying glass icon next to it, saying, "Hey, pick me up, you need me." As truly awesome as that is, it can still be annoying to keep track of what you need for different recipes, as they all share similar components, and you can track multiple recipes at the same time. What that means is, if you need a spring for both your pipe rifle and a minigun mod, you can highlight compatible items in the world that will work for both, but you have absolutely no way of knowing when you've acquired enough for one upgrade or the other. This system also tends to make me pick up any piece of even pseudo-useful-looking shit I find lying around. Whereas before I wouldn't even have given a toaster or a phone a second look, my bags are now full of them. That and spoons, gas cans, a Braxo cleaner, and everything else. Loot all the things. It's actually pretty badass that all the crap lying around in these games is for once an actual impact on how you play the game. But it can be a little overwhelming. That being said, the game also makes this aspect almost unbelievably hassle-free. When you get back to your base, there's a simple store all junk option, so you can go from overloaded bags to a clean bag in a single click. Not only that, you can directly access these resources while crafting, so you never have to actually pull the materials out when you're crafting inside your base. The downside to this is that each base has its own separate supply, so you'll need to be careful about where you store things, but you can choose to spend a perk point to make that a non-issue as well. You can no longer repair guns, nor do they need it, but you also can't really do anything with them in your inventory until you get back to weapons crafting stations, where unwanted extras can be disposed of to claim some resources. I'm fairly ambivalent about the lack of repairing, which was an important mainstay to every previous Fallout game, but it does seem odd that they would make ammunition of greater concern but remove repair entirely. It's also inconvenient that you can't dispose of guns on the go, and that when you do finally get back to base and salvage them, they don't seem to yield the same resources that would be required to craft them. So 12 pistols equals 36 steel? No springs anywhere in there? No plastic or wood? Really? But I do have 2 huge gripes with the crafting system, and it kind of goes hand in hand with how they design item drops from enemies and how these systems interact with perk choices, but it all comes down to the same thing. The ammo system in this game is terrible, and the decision to remove the reloading bench from the game was also terrible. I don't want to elaborate on this too much in the crafting system because what it mainly affects is character progression, so I'll leave the bulk of that discussion to there. But just know that the lack of ability to craft ammunition is the most tragic loss to game mechanics moving forward from New Vegas. That alone could remove a great deal of my negative feelings about the game. Not because I live spending all day at the reloading bench, but the second gripe is with the lack of gun crafting. So we can mod every last weapon we come across to the nth degree, but we've somehow lost the knowledge of how to build them? Doesn't make any sense to me. Since 2 out of every 3 weapons I come across is a pipe rifle or pipe pistol, literally, it would be nice if unlocking higher ranks of gun nut would allow me to craft some less shitty weapons, rather than waiting for the RNG gods to grace me with something. That and the fact that I now have a giant stockpile of 45 and 50 caliber rounds and nothing to use them in, while I can barely keep enough 308 and 10mm rounds around to survive. The final topic in this subject of crafting is base building. And I haven't invested too much time in this as of yet, though I'll certainly mess with it when I have more time to play and I've got to experience some other mechanics, but so far, it's pretty neat. You can salvage just about anything within your own base, even the buildings themselves, and build new things from the ground up. Conveniently enough, most of what you need for new buildings is contained in what's already lying around your base, so you don't have to stray too far away to build basic things. Speaking of which, base buildings comes with a take care of your survivors aspect, so you do have to build functional items like power generators and water pumps, but it hasn't really been a hassle so far. Those of you that aren't really interested in base building will probably be relieved by that fact. Based on what I've seen, it seems like you'll probably be able to invest as little or as much energy and time into it as you like, which I think is probably the best way to handle it. I think you'd be somewhat remiss if you avoided it entirely, but I doubt there's anything to keep you from completing the game if you take that approach. Our final topic is character customization slash progression. So far, and I predicted this, my biggest concern is and remains character customization. First of all, anytime you take three character building systems, in this case, skills, special, and perks, and boil them down into one, you're playing with fire. Sometimes less really is less. Their decision to go with this new system has concerned me from the moment they announced it, and the effects of those decisions are now being brought to light as I experience the game more. First of all, while special is more important than ever, you receive less special points during character creation than previous games. In the past, you started with 5 in every stat and had 5 points to distribute as you saw fit, with the option to play with the already distributed points as well. That makes for a total of 40 points to start out, assuming no special perks were taken. By Fallout 4, with a base of 1 in each special stat and only 21 to distribute, you start with a mere 28. Ouch. Now, many people will come back with, yeah, but there's endless leveling and you can increase your special as you level. And that is true, but it's also true that getting everything in the game in a single playthrough will be inordinately difficult, and it should be. And you're also starting off with much less defined about your character than in any previous game. And speaking of which, you also get to define much smaller amounts about yourself with each new level. With skill points gone, you get exactly 1 special slash perk point to distribute with each level up. So that's obviously much less customizable than it was. Whereas before, you got a perk every other level and a variable amount of skill points each level based on your intelligence. So you could be developing 2 different things at the same time. For instance, building your gun skill while taking a perk to help craft ammunition. To this, many will say, but you level up faster. But that isn't really all that true in my experience. At 5 intelligence, I feel like I level very slowly. And while quests give great experience, usually an entire level's worth, at least so far, enemy experience rewards are pitiful. Super mutants are worth a mere 19 or so, and the highest number I've seen from a single enemy was 115 from a world boss, who incidentally took 12 missiles to kill, so... Speaking of levels, not only did they condense the 3 systems into one, they've also placed seemingly arbitrary level gates where they did not exist before. I'm talking specifically about weapon skills, though while the same is true of every other perk, the vast majority of perks in previous games had level requirements on them, so while annoying, this isn't exactly unprecedented. The gun skills, however, are ridiculous. In previous Fallout games, with weapon damage slash ability tied to skills, you could pump them at whatever rate you wanted. If you took the right perks and had a high intelligence, you could easily cap any weapon skill by level 5 in Fallout New Vegas, and even sooner in Fallout 3. Here, it's not possible. All perks over rank 1 have level requirements on them, which I didn't discover until I tried to drop a second point into heavy weapons damage, only to discover that I wouldn't be eligible to do so until level 11. To me, this is bad design and lazy oversight. At the very least, weapon skills should be excluded from level requirements to put them in line with the previous games. It's very reminiscent of Far Cry's ambiguous gating of skills through quest events, and serves, I guess, as some artificial means of game balance. Meanwhile, I just like the freedom to design my character how I want to. If I want to forego more support-type skills in favor of building up my combat skills early, I'd like the freedom to do so. Combining 3 systems into one and then placing level restrictions to further restrict freedom of character progression is just an insult. And speaking of insulting, I've already talked about the ammunition issue, but now it's time to discuss what that really means for this game. When you present a billion guns and gun mods and variations, etc., then you offer perks to go along with them, that all sounds great. But guess what? None of that matters if you don't have any bullets to shoot with them. 90% of what I've seen so far, both guns and ammo, has been .38 caliber. Following that, 10mm and then some .308. 45, 5mm on rare occasions, and intermittent 50 caliber rounds, which I still don't have a gun to shoot out of. So, when I started this playthrough, I said what I'd really like to do for my first character is a heavy weapons build. It was the build with which I had the most fun in Fallout New Vegas. I loved wrecking shit and taking names with the CZ-57 Avenger. It was awesome. Now, granted, you had to know that that unique gun existed and you had to go find it, but there were many other options for heavy weapons in New Vegas, and they were all legitimately, quote-unquote, end-game type guns. That's fine. I was surprised then to be given a minigun so early in Fallout 4, with a pretty meager, at least for a minigun, amount of ammo to go along with it, and that ammo's long since gone. Since that time, I have found maybe 100 rounds of 5mm in various containers, and I'm not allowed to craft it. And of the very few merchants that I've seen, none of them carry it. Not to mention buying ammo is very expensive. So I can't craft it, I can't buy it, and I can barely find it anywhere, and not to mention with any regularity or predictability. So after all I've experienced thus far, the only people who would seem to have pretty much carte blanche access to their melee weapon, or excuse me, their weapons of choice would be those that went with the build centered around pipe pistols and rifles or melee. Everyone else, go screw yourself. So what the hell, Bethesda? I mean, what I'm getting at here is that virtually no matter what weapon build you try to go with, they've actually purposely designed a system that forces you to use guns from other categories throughout most of the game by way of purposefully limiting your access to ammunition for your primary weapons. Unless that is you center your build around the almighty 38 caliber round. So in effect, what they've done is designed yet another system that limits build variety. Now, you can't do 100% big guns in New Vegas. Hell, you don't even have access to a big gun at all for several hours unless you cheat or can somehow access or can somehow survive Cazadors and a giant pack of Centaurs to get to the CZ-57 early on. Even then, you'd be hard up for ammunition for a long time. But at this rate, I fully expect that you won't be able to really pick your build from an ammunition standpoint throughout the entirety of Fallout 4. Nothing I've seen convinces me otherwise. And that really, really bothers me. Even an NPC crafter that you can set to work on producing a specific type of ammo in your base would have solved this, and it would play well with their new base building mechanic, but I guess that's just me. I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention the power armor system, which I'm not a huge fan of. I think it's introduced far too early and ends up being very gimmicky rather than an actual build choice. Only one perk plays into it, that's the Strength 10 one, other than crafting new pieces, of course, but it's also now tied to the weird fusion core system. It was a very odd design decision in my opinion, with the net result of it not getting to use it very much, but also getting to use it way too early. I don't know. Unless you go fusion core hunting the whole game, but that's just, I don't know. It seems silly to me. All in all, I feel that the character progression slash customization is a net loss, a setback in fact, and that's disappointing, especially coming from a series to which I usually point people when making recommendations for good RPG build a character type games. So what's the verdict? Well, very positive so far. I'll be interested to see what they have in store for us in DLC, and I can't comment on every last quest and side area in the game because I just haven't experienced all of them. But I do have faith, based on what I've seen so far, that there will be plenty of interesting things to do in the game. There are two observations worth making here that kind of sum up the game as a whole. The first is that it's an improvement over its predecessors in almost every way. Some merely noticeable and some major. A more stable engine, better defined and designed mechanics for the most part, much better combat, and a deep crafting system. All this is important and good, and is to Bethesda's credit. However, the second point is that they did not do a good job of escaping from the previous negative things that defined them, especially relative to other games that have come out. The lack of customizability of graphics options and key rebinds are causing a major headache to a lot of PC gamers, with workarounds of variable success. The frame rate, field of view, and several other important options can only be modified by manually editing files and can cause some serious issues with the game. Some keys can't be rebound to other keys, and some can't be changed at all. The UI and menus, while better than they were in the past, still reek of consoles and have shoddy, inconsistent keyboard and mouse support. Bethesda, unfortunately, is notorious among the PC crowd for lack of attention to detail when it comes to these aspects of their games, and in these areas, they have not made any real progress here. That's disappointing, especially considering how well most of the rest of the game is doing. They might still release some patches to address these concerns, but given their track record, I rather doubt it. Most of that will be fixed by modders, and in the meantime, people who are truly bothered by these things will either have to suffer through it, take a chance on workarounds, or just wait. And that's the real disappointment. It's a tragedy that Fallout New Vegas' well-deserved reputation will always bear the mar of its rocky release. I'd hate for Bethesda's somewhat sloppy attention to the PC port in terms of UI and a couple other aspects to have the same effect on Fallout 4. For me personally, these kinds of gripes are rather minor in comparison to crashes, poor optimization, and game-breaking bugs. But I certainly respect other people's feeling on the matter, and moreover, so should Bethesda. I really shouldn't have to be mentioning this at all. Even a few PC Master Race-minded QA testers could and should have pointed these things out, and if these concerns were brought up, they should have been addressed. So I'd hate to think either, that they were either tragically ignorant of these deficiencies, or that they were aware and decided to do nothing. Neither option reflects very well on them. And of course, the RPG mechanics are also stepped back from the entire series to date, allowing less customization and freedom than ever before, albeit by a relatively marginal amount, all seemingly in the name of streamlining or simplifying the game or something like that. That being said, the game as a whole is outstanding, despite the various concerns I've enumerated throughout this review. It didn't break ground in a new territory, but presented respectable improvements in most major areas, and, on the PC at least, had the most stable launch we've seen in a decade of Bethesda games. It's not quite the genre-redefining game that I was hoping for, not a Skyrim or a Fallout New Vegas, but as is usual with Bethesda, when we compare their games, we're usually quibbling over degrees of greatness. Bethesda rarely delivers anything but great. And they've done it again. It might not fully stand up to all my expectations, it might not fully stand up to its own predecessors in some ways, but in the market as a whole, it's a shining example of exactly how a good game should be made. All factors considering, my verdict is a solid 8.0 out of 10. So good work, Bethesda, and keep making games.